Sure, you could hear Emma singing. They had a problem with the mic, so we'll have to get her to do that again. We'll put a box up here and let her stand here. This mic catches everything anybody says. So, Ephesians chapter number 1. We've proceeded today the opportunity to reach verse number 2. It's only taken 4 weeks, so we're making blazing speed going through the book of Ephesians already. Verse number 2 I want to look at it today, and as I was thinking about this passage and have thought about it as I'm preparing to teach, I thought, well, you know, this is a verse everybody just reads over, and yet there's a tremendous amount of material in the verse. And then I started thinking about it, and all of a sudden I had 2 weeks' worth of material, and then thought a little more and had 3 weeks, and I said, I'm not going to spend 3 weeks in verse 2. But we are going to spend 2 weeks in it. Today I'd just like to look at it. And the next time I want to try to see how it fits with other books. All of Paul's epistles, verse number 2, he says, grace be to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord Jesus Christ. In every one of Paul's 13 epistles, that statement almost exactly that way appears in the first couple of verses of each book. It's interesting, preachers like to point out that when you read Timothy and Titus, 1st, 2nd Timothy and Titus, the pastoral epistles over there, that he doesn't just say grace and peace, he says grace, mercy, and peace. And Alex is going over verse this morning, in wrath, remember mercy. And when he's writing to pastors about dealing with people, he adds mercy. And I don't know if that's true or not about I'm sure it's not true why he added mercy there, because had he known you, he would have never thought about needing mercy. You know, mercy, grace is God giving you what you don't deserve. Mercy is he's holding back what you do deserve. It's that kind of backward thing. And when you work together in the local assembly, there has to be a little bit of that not giving people something back, you know, when you just think, well, they deserve it, you know. So there needs to be a little mercy. But the grace and peace from God our Father, and for the Lord Jesus Christ, it's a common expression. In fact, in all of Paul's epistles, he starts out in the greeting with that. But it's also found in non-Pauline epistles. And it's important to see the doctrinal and dispensational significance of the greeting and the particular point that it's making. So I'm going to say that mainly for next week. Today, I just want you to look at the verse. Just starting in verse 1, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, to the saints which are at Ephesus, and to the faithful in Christ Jesus. It's always been fascinating to me. In all of the epistles, the first word of them tells you who wrote them. Now, 1st, 2nd, 3rd John, I know, is an exception, but all the rest do. And it's, you know, we write a letter. You get a letter from somebody, you got to look at the last page to see who signed it to know who wrote it. You know, they used to be in business communication that if you didn't have a letterhead, you put your name and address at the beginning, then the date, then the recipient's name and address. If you've got a letterhead, then you don't have to do that. But in most correspondence, you get a letter from somebody, and you got to look at the last page to see who wrote it. Paul, when he wrote a letter, he put his name first, so you know who wrote it. And, you know, I like that because if you know who writes it, you know whether you want to read it or not. Because sometimes, you know, you read something and say, I just have not read that, considering who it came from. So right up at the beginning, he does it, and he writes to the saints and to the faithful in Christ Jesus. And I remind you what we talked about last time about that. These were not just people who were saints positionally. They were not just saints because they were in Christ and had trusted him and were saved, but they were the faithful in Christ Jesus. These were saints who had begun to take it seriously and who had become fully engaged in the edification process. They were growing. They were mature people. Now, maturity is a wonderful thing. You never get over it. You never get beyond it. You're always able to grow older and more mature and more, but they're in the process. They're not babies anymore. They've grown to adulthood. They've come to the place where they can assimilate the sound doctrine. 1 Corinthians 2, he told them, the Corinthians, he says, I determined to know nothing among you save Jesus Christ and him crucified, because you're not able to bear any more than that. And then he's told them in 1 Corinthians 2, 6, we looked at it, but we speak the wisdom of God among them that are perfect. even the hidden wisdom. In other words, there's some more for you to know than just about your salvation. There's some more for you to know than just the fact that God, that Jesus Christ died for you and paid for your sins and can take you off the road to hell and put you into the road to heaven, and that he's equipped you to live here now as a member of the body of Christ. He's equipped you to be able to live victorious in life, that that's the sins of life, that sin-loving sinner that you used to be isn't your identity anymore. And now, rather than, it's not I, it's not that old me, it's not all that self-life, it's not who I was before I met Christ, and it's not all those patterns of life that I always used to get my spiritual needs met. We all need love, we all need acceptance, we all need forgiveness, we all need purpose and meaning in life. And apart from Christ, we have these mechanisms that we use, no matter what they are. Some people it's money, some people it's sex, some people it's education, some people it's religion, some people it's whatever it's going to be for you. And whatever it is, whatever the things are that you have, you in your background develop the ability to protect yourself and defend yourself and to promote yourself, and all that self-life that you had, the ways that you had developed and learned to meet your needs for love and acceptance and significance and importance and for forgiveness, all those things that you had done, all your resources, when you trust Christ, it's all those things didn't get me there. But he does. And now I have forgiveness. Now I have acceptance. Now I have purpose and meaning in life. And I'm not on a treadmill trying to do enough things. You know, if I just keep peddling, I'll get there. I'm already there in Christ. And because of who I am in him, and because who of God's made me in him, who of God has made unto us wisdom and righteousness, sanctification, redemption, all these wonderful things. Now I'm equipped to live that life that God's given me in him. That's what the saint is, understanding a saint. The faithful is someone who's said, I've got that. Now, the Corinthians didn't have it. The Corinthians still were stumbling around in all these things with the flesh. They still thought back there that I love the thing in Numbers about Israel. They get out in the wilderness, and it says they start lusting for the leeks and the garlics back in the garlic back in Egypt. Back there we had some. They just keep remembering that stuff. They'd never been to Canaan yet. They hadn't eaten the old corn in Canaan. They got the manna. But, you know, they must not have had any good chefs or something. They should have come to the men's breakfast yesterday. Manna is a good thing to eat, but you know, you have to have a little creativity in making it, and they're just all bored with it, you know. It's over and it's bored. If they'd have remembered how hungry they were before they got it, how scared they were of starving before they got it, and they remember how exciting it was when they got it, that it met those needs. You know, 30 years later, it wouldn't have been quite so boring to them. But anyway, they start lusting back for the old life. And they forgot what that old life was. It was a life of bondage. It was a life where there was no freedom, no liberty. I love that passage in 1 Peter 4. He says, let's let the time of the past suffice for doing the will of the Gentiles. You know, I spent enough time not knowing what life was, not knowing who I was, not understanding what my purpose in life was, not having any real acceptance, not having the ability just to relax and think and know if everything blows apart, I'm still okay because I'm in Christ. That's enough. I'm going to get serious about who I really am in Christ. Well, that's what the Ephesians got there. And David said it earlier, you got to take it seriously. And there comes a point when you do, and you move into adulthood. Then when you become an adult, and I have, over the past 30 plus years, I've grayed before you, you know. And you get older as an adult, and then you come, you know. But the maturity process keeps going. Some of you are young. You're an adult, you're mature, you begin to have your family, you begin to have life, jobs and careers and so forth, and you know, you're growing up and you have all of life ahead of you, and there's more growth coming for you. And you get over in the other end of life and you look back and you can see where you came from. Well, that's where the Ephesians are. Now, they're in some level of that maturity. So they are mature saints, and they're functioning. They've learned to apply sound doctrine to the details of life. They've learned to take the truth of God's word and see it transform their thinking. That verse in 1 Peter 4, you ought to read that sometime. He says, you know what you need to do? You need to arm your mind with this thinking. Paul would say, renew your mind. He'd say, put on the helmet of salvation. He'd say, put on the girdle of truth. Get your life cinched up, controlled by the truth of God's word, and let it be the word of God that works effectually in you that believe. And someone says, I can't do that. If you're a believer, don't call God a liar. He says you can. He says you're free. He says you're dead to sin. And when you think, every time you go out and try to think, that's where that self-life, that self-will, is where you're going to find what you're looking for. You're being programmed by error. You're being programmed by the lie. It isn't true. And it'll fail. You need to come and put your faith where God puts his faith, and that's in who he's made you in Christ. And then grow in that. And you move from, you get all that, what I've been talking about, you get all that in Romans. There's the foundation. And now you come to Ephesians, and we're going to grow. We're going to move on out of just it being about me and who I am in Christ, and I'm not Adam, I'm in Christ, and how I've been equipped to live in that identity. And now he's going to say, here's what he's going to use us for. But in the midst of all of that, as he points to these people, verse number 2, grace be to you and peace from God our Father, from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Now that's more than just a formality. You know, we greet people, we say, hey, how you doing? And you answer back, fine, how are you? And neither one of you meant it. You know, that's true. If you speak, you know, in all, every language has that kind of greeting. Como está usted? We're bien. Gracias. ¿Y usted? You know, don't mean that. How you doing? Okay. How about you? You know, when? Good. You know, now let's talk. Can we talk? And you say, well, I don't really tell people how I'm doing because I'd have to give an organ recital and I'm not in tune. It's a formality. You know, it's the way we greet people. Well, that's not what this verse is. Most of the time, that's what people say it is. But because Paul uses it in every epistle, people think, well, that's just Paul's way of saying grace. That's the charis, the Greek word. I mean, the word charis, or charis, some people would say, is the Greek word that's translated grace. And it literally has the idea of, we get our word charming, charm from it. And it's the idea of lovely, something that's beautiful, it's lovely, that's soothing. And people say, well, that's the Gentile way of saying hello. And peace, well, that's shalom, that's the Jewish way of saying hello. So it's just a formality. Well, it wasn't just a formality, and it wasn't a simple, hey, how you doing, let's pass on, talk something important. There's some things in this passage. Paul lays out two things that every person is desperate for. And it's two of the great heritages of a believer. Two things that you have, listen, no matter what the circumstances. Because they didn't come from circumstances. They weren't earth-born blessings. They came from God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. Where's God the Father at? He's in heaven. Where's the Lord Jesus Christ? He's on exile in heaven. That's where these things come from. They descend from the Father. They come to you through Jesus Christ. And there are two vital things that every person is desperate. And by the way, every place in the Scripture that I know of, they're always in this order. It's always grace and then peace. You never see peace and then grace. Grace is the source. Peace is the effect of the source. Grace is this It's all God's power and all of God's love and all of God's wisdom that's available to us. It wraps up all that God is and all that God offers to us. And grace is God at work on our behalf and in our lives. And then peace, well, that's simply freedom from anxiety, freedom from fear, freedom from worry. When we were in Philippians chapter 4, I tried to show you that peace is that relaxed mental attitude that comes into your life, that tranquility that comes into your soul simply by resting in an intelligent understanding of God's grace to you in Christ. Peace is that sense of security, that sense of trust. I just can't get over the term, the sense of rest. How wonderful it is to be able to rest in God's grace. And that's what peace is. And grace and peace, Paul says, grace be to you and peace. Here's the ultimate thing you're going to get out of what Paul teaches you. Grace and peace from God the Father and from our Lord Jesus Christ. Grace is usually defined as unmerited favor. Now that's nothing wrong with that definition, but it's very truncated, and it isn't always accurate in every passage where you find the term grace, by the way. Grace really is something a little more of a doctrinal kind of a content than it is just a word that you're going to get a dictionary meaning out of it. There are two passages that kind of flesh out the meaning. Look with me at John chapter 1 in one hand and Romans chapter number 3. John chapter 1. And Romans chapter 3. I've pointed this verse out to you in John 1 on a number of occasions, but I want to do it again. John 1 and Romans chapter 3. John chapter 1, as John finishes the introduction to his book, he says this in verse 17. John 1, 17. And this is John the Baptist's actual testimony. For the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. Now, most of the time people get caught up in this verse about the law coming by Moses, Moses being the issue in the Old Covenant, and grace and truth came by Jesus Christ, that Jesus Christ being the New Covenant. But I just want you to notice the terms in the verse about the law was given by Moses. And I said to you before, you can give something to someone from a distance. And in the law, distance was always the issue. In the law, there was a separation. The people stood without. The Gentiles couldn't even come close. The nation Israel stood without, and only the priest went into the temple. And then only one man of all of Israel, once a year, went into the very presence of God in the Holy of Holies. The law required a 1, 2, 3-step separation. The law came. The law was given by Moses. It was sent by Moses. But grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. You came here this morning. You know what that is? You're personally present. When you come somewhere, your presence arrives there. Grace wasn't sent, you see. Grace came in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace isn't given from afar. Grace is something that's up close and personal because it arrives and it focuses and it comes in Jesus Christ. So when you understand grace, you're understanding it's something about God's connection with you that's up close and personal. This is not some system of doctrine, some theology that you get from a distance and that you hold out there. This is something that comes right in. Now, Romans chapter 3, you'll see Paul's definition. Romans 3:24, I think, is the great verse in the Scripture that defines the grace of God for you. Romans 3:24, Paul says, being justified freely by his grace. Now watch. Through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. If anything else is clear, one thing is certain. In whom we have, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. The grace of God is all that God is free to give to you through the finished work of Jesus Christ at Calvary. Through the redemption that's in Christ Jesus. God's grace is what he's able to bestow upon you. We talked about unmerited favor. What is that? That's all that God can do for you through the work of the Lord Jesus Christ at Calvary. Everything he won there through this redemption that's in Christ Jesus comes under this category of grace. For years I've thought about it as people talk about love, God's love. And God loves, and God's love, God so loved the world. God commended his love toward us. A man wrote a book recently called Love Wins. Big controversy about that. And the idea is that in the end, God's love is going to reconcile everybody back to him, even the devil. And you think, well, wait a minute. That might be a little too much. Love never lets you all go. Love will never let you down. But love also doesn't let you off. When you let someone off from responsibility for the choice in their actions, you're called an enabler. You're not a friend. Love will stand there with you as you have to deal with the problem, but it will require you and equip you to deal with the problem. It won't just push it under the rug like it isn't real. And God looks down at you through history, and he sees you, and he loves you. He fixed his love upon you, and he loves you with an everlasting love. But there's a problem. David was reading about it a moment ago. Through the disobedience of one, you know what? You're disobedient. You're a sinner. Sin is rebellion against God. I'll do it my way, not your way. And when God looks at you and he loves you, he'll love you in spite of your sin, but love isn't all that God is. God is righteous. God is just. His throne, the book of Psalms talks about, you know, there's not a verse in the Bible that says his throne is established in his sovereignty. That's an interesting idea for you theologians. But his throne is established in his righteousness and in his justice. These are the attributes, the personal attributes of God that establish what he does and who he is. And his justice, righteousness, looks at you and says, you come short. And love says, but I still love him. But righteousness says, but we got a problem. And justice says, the problem is you came short. And the justice of God is sort of like the enforcer of the righteousness. God's holiness is made up of his righteousness and his justice. Two of his characteristics. And justice says he can't come in. Because he's a sinner. And God's love still is attached. And yet, you're unrighteous. And so the love of God, not to be outdone, goes to the wisdom of God, another one of his attributes, and says, can't you figure a way to fix this? And the wisdom of God says, well, we can't change who we are. We're righteous. So what do we need to do? We need to change who you are and make you righteous. And the wisdom of God, that's why Paul says we speak the wisdom of God, the wisdom of God in a mystery. That's why he says that the mystery that we preach, this message we preach, declares and sets forth the manifold wisdom of God. That's why he says that in him, in Christ, are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. The wisdom of God devised a plan that he called grace. You see, grace is not one of the characteristics of God. Grace is the plan of God whereby his character can include you too. And so grace is all that God's wisdom has designed to accomplish your and I's redemption and life. So those his attributes aren't in conflict with one another. They work together. And so the wisdom of God made the plan. In fact, if you go down to the verse number, if you go back with me to Ephesians 1, if you go down to, you see how he says in verse 1, grace be to you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. If you go down to verse number 7, in whom we have redemption through his blood, talking about Christ, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. I use that title, the riches of his grace, for our radio program. One of the things, that expression, the riches of his grace, in order for God to manifest and express his grace, it cost him a lot. That's why he had to be rich to do it. You ever wanted to buy something and you didn't have the wherewithal to do it? You weren't rich enough? God was rich. And when he talks about his grace, he's talking about it in the context of the costliness of his grace. And it cost God. Listen, don't let anybody ever tell you this thing about cheap grace. Anything that costs God the life of his own son, the second person of the Godhead, the one that back in the Old Testament he calls him the apple of his eye, the one in whom he finds all of his delight. Paul says that it pleased the Father that in him should all fullness dwell. The Father made him to be the preeminent one. The hero of the Father's heart is his son. And that's what it cost him. It cost the son, though he were rich, yet for your sakes he became poor. 2 Corinthians 8, verse 9, Paul says, we know the grace of God. Though he were rich, yet he became poor. It cost God. It cost God the Son. But the plan goes way back. Verse number 9, having made known unto us the mystery of his will, as the Father's will, according to his good pleasure, notice, which he purposed in himself. That discussion I was describing a moment ago between the love of God and the righteousness of God and the justice of God and the wisdom of God, I was just describing something about the thought process that went on in the heart, in the innermost being of God himself. He has a plan. He's working out a plan today that he purposed in himself. It's a plan that comes out of his innermost being. That's why down in verse 17, he's called the Father of Glory. Glory is the name of the plan. That's why all the times when you read about glory in the Bible, 1 Peter 4, I was mention it again, he talks about some things happening and then the spirit of grace and glory rest upon you. You know what that is? That's the outworking of the plan, living in their life. So grace is a wonderful thing. It's not enough just to say, it's unmerited favor. Well, you know you didn't deserve it. But, you know, you look next to you at your spouse and you didn't deserve her either, you know. Thank goodness you married up a little bit. Some of us a lot. Yeah, that's right. So you can say, I got undeserved favor there. But this is something far more than that. It's really the content of everything God has planned from the innermost sanctuary of his own heart to accomplish through his son, and you're a part of it. It's given to you. Wow, that's a big thing. See, Ephesians is going to be a big, exciting book. Grace be to you. Now, by the way, in John chapter 1, verse 17, he's talking about grace involved in Israel's program. Jeremiah 31, verse 2, he talks about in the day when Israel will be taken out into the wilderness of the tribulation, and he says they will find grace in the wilderness. Just as they did back in Exodus when he brought them out the first time, so they will the second time. And they'll have learned the lesson of the old covenant that it's not I can't do it, I fail. The law is weak through my flesh, through your flesh. But you learn to have a new identity. Not in who I'm trusting, not in who I've done, but in what God's done for me and who God has made me in his son. I'm not that sin-loving sinner anymore. I'm ashamed of the Most High God. You say, but I still find myself loving sin. But you're still ashamed of the Most High God. How big of a contradiction is that? You see, that's why you go, huh, you know, going down life's road like nothing's happened. Oh, that didn't work. You might be like a blind bat flying backwards in a dark cave. You're going to hit the wall. Spat! You'd be like the bug that hit the guy's windshield, you know. You won't have the guts to do that again. One of the kids asked me, he says, well, what's the last thing to go through that bug's mind? I said, I don't know. He said, his rear end. Well, you know what that is? That's you trying to be somebody you're not. And you know what? It doesn't work. You know that. Because that's not the grace of God. The grace of God is who God's made you in his Son. Israel, everything God ever does with Israel will be based upon what God's accomplished through the cross work of Christ. When they stand before him, Revelation 5, they say, worthy is the Lamb. Why? He was slain. Now, when you come to us, we're a bunch of unprophesied Gentiles, unprophesied program, the body of Christ. Ephesians 2, Paul says, if you've heard of the dispensation of the grace of God given to me, to you, or how that by revelation made known to me the mystery, how that I could go out and preach the unsearchable riches of Christ, about how God would include you and me too. So grace isn't exclusively for us, but it's wonderfully, marvelously, unexpectedly for us. And then he says, peace. Because once you've got that grace, it brings peace. Peace means to join together or fasten together something that's been broken or separated. We would say, I like the word tranquility. But really, peace is the idea of a cessation of againstness. Look with me at Romans chapter 5. Romans chapter 5, verse 1. Therefore, being justified by God, we have peace with God. Being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. By the way, grace will only accept one response. Grace will not accept your works. Here, Lord, I give you my works for your grace. It won't do that. The only response grace will accept, it's by faith that it might be of grace. The only response grace will accept is faith. Because faith is the only thing you can do without doing anything. There's no merit in faith. The merit is in the person that's being believed, not the person believing. The merit's in what's being believed, not who's believing it. The only response grace will accept is faith. And being justified by faith, we have peace with God. Now, peace with God, why do you need that? Well, if you go down to verse number 9, he says, much more than being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. Well, if there's wrath, I think I need some peace. If there's war, I need some peace. For if when we were enemies, you see, our status was we were enemies of God, we're at war with God, in our mind, with wicked works, Colossians 1:21 says. Alienated, separated. And God brings peace. He brings a cessation of God ever being against us or of us being against God. No longer do I want to live apart from him. And no longer does he desire to be apart, demand to be apart from me. There's a cessation. Peace is not just nobody's fighting. Because a lot of times you can have nobody fighting externally, you know. And yet, take the handcuffs off and what happens? They go back at it. You see that among nations. You see it among individuals. But when there's a change comes down inside, and the reason to be against someone, the reason to be against yourself is taken away. I've said to you many times, I know that I don't need to beat you up. You do a good job of that yourself. You'll see your failures and you'll say, you know, what a fool I was. Because getting caught up in it, but the end, didn't get you where you wanted to go. And then you look at it, and now you've got another defeat. You've got another blank hole, another wasted whatever. You take care of that yourself, don't you? Wow, wow. God says, I take care of that. 2,000 years ago, I knew what you were going to do, and Jesus Christ died on the cross for that 2,000 years ago. I loved you ahead of time. I provided for you ahead of time. And I made peace. Now, I'm at peace. Why don't you be? The only way you can be, see, that's God's grace, is believe what God believes and rest in it. And when you do, you know what happens? Tranquility. Isaiah 57, he says, there is no peace, saith my God, for the wicked. They're like the troubled sea that with the waves roaring, tossing to and fro, mire and dirt. And I think, isn't that like the life of a lost person? Isn't that like the life that sin brings to you? Just an uproar all the time at war. Alex, in the earlier meeting, talking about doing war games and how that in the middle of a battle, it's nothing but confusion. Tossing mire and clay. Just throwing dirt at everybody you can. Tossing junk at everybody. Accusations. Muck and mire. Verbally, physically, activities. Tempestuous. No way to solve it. The Lord Jesus Christ went out upon the Sea of Galilee with his disciples in a boat, went down into the cabin and went to sleep. Great tempest arose. They're tossed to and fro. In the Sea of Galilee, you're not in big ocean liners. You're in small little boats. And they're tossed to and fro. And they go wake the Lord up and say, Lord, carest thou not that we perish? How canst I lie asleep when we're dying? And the Lord looked up at him and he says, oh, how can the winds and the waves destroy the one that made them? And he looked across that tempest and he said, peace, be still. You remember that, Mark 4. And the clouds evaporated away. And the sky began to smile. And the tempest died to a glassy calm. And that was just a picture of what he intended to do for the nation Israel and what he does for you and me, peace. Isn't that wonderful? To know everything's okay. Then there's the peace, not just with God, but Philippians chapter 4. Now I'm glad I taught Philippians 4 before I taught Ephesians 1. Philippians 4, verse number 6, it says, be careful for nothing. Don't stand there looking at the winds and the waves and say, carest thou not that we perish? Lord, don't you care about me? Why, if you love me, would you let these things happen in my life? Why me, Lord? See, you've been there, done that. You were poking fingers at those disciples, and turns out you've been in the boat with them. But in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And everything goes on in life. Just turn to the Lord. Talk to him about what's going on. Be specific about it. Bring him into the details of your life and what happens. And the peace of God which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. You see, there's that peace that comes into the details of your life and fills up your heart. And it's only a consciousness of your possession of God's grace, of your possession of that divine favor, of all that God can do for you and has done for you in His Son. It's only that that can create and sustain that kind of tranquility, the peace of God. That's the peace God has when He looks at Calvary. If you'll let your mind run back to when we were studying that, I spent about a half an hour one Sunday morning. I'm not going to do it now. I'll remind you of it and believe that you can pull that information out of your frame of reference, okay? But in John 14, Jesus, the night before He died, says this to His disciples, "My peace I leave you." Not as the world gives, give I unto you. My peace. Imagine that, the night before He's going to, just a short hours before He's going to go out into the garden, He's going to ask His disciples to pray for Him. They're going to fail Him. He's going to come out of that garden, and He's going to have one of His friends betray Him into the hands of His enemies. He's going to be taken out and physically, verbally abused in the most horrendous of ways. And then He's going to be taken to a cross and die, forsaken, under the weight and load of your sin, and pay the penalty for your sin. And all of that, anticipating it, and the emotional draining impact as He looked into that cup when He's in the garden. He looks into that cup and He says, "Father, if it's possible, let this cup pass from Me." And as He prayed by Himself, forsaken of all of His apostles, left alone with just Him and the Father, as He prayed, the impact was so tremendous that He sweat drops of blood. That verse in Hebrews 12, it says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before Him endured the cross, despising the shame. Then that verse goes on to say, consider Him, because you haven't yet resisted unto blood, striving against sin. The problems you've had, when was the last time you sweat drops of blood? I know you've thought you did. It seemed like you did, but it never was that intense for most of us. And there He was. And in the face of all that, He says, "My peace. I've got peace. I have a relaxed mental attitude about what's fixing to happen to me. I know all about it. I know all the verses. I know everything Scripture says. It's all going to be accomplished. And I'm just at peace about this." That didn't come from His circumstances. You know what that came from? When He came out of that garden in John 18, and Peter, these guys come after Him with the sticks and the staff. You remember that? You know, they're going to take Him. "We got it. We're going to get Him. Here He is. Let's get Him. You know, we're going to get Him." He said, "Who are you looking for? You looking for Jesus? I'm He." They all fell on their backside. Now, I don't know about you, but if a guy could speak a word and knock the whole crowd down, if I was in the crowd, I'd be kind of wanting somebody else to be on the front line next time. They didn't overtake Him. He surrendered. Second time they come at Him, old Pete pulls out the sword and tries to whack off one of their heads. Pete's ready to fight. Pete wasn't ready to surrender. What offended Peter was that he gave up without a fight. Pete didn't know what was going on. But He turns to Peter and says, "Put up the sword, Pete. The cup which the Father hath given Me, shall I not drink it?" You know how He came out of that garden? He came out of that garden with a peace of complete, total dependence upon the plan and the will of His Father. He knew where His Father's heart was, and He trusted it. That kind of peace, where you know what God the Father, so what's in His heart. You know this plan that's come from His innermost being. You've been allowed to see it because you've come to the truth. That's what Ephesians does, is it lays all of that out for us. It reveals it for us. And he trusted it. That's God's peace. That's the peace of God. That's why it says it passes all understanding. You're never going to be able to write that down in a definition. It's beyond being able to define it in terms that words can adequately express. Well, I try. I try to say it to you. And every time I try to say it, I'm conscious of the fact that I missed the mark. I didn't get it all in. And if it took more than an hour, I took hours and hours and hours. I can't do it. Because it's beyond fully comprehending. Ephesians 2, verse 7, it says that in the ages to come, he shall show forth the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness toward us. It's going to take all of the ages to come to fully, and then you aren't going to get it done. Manifest that. Well, so, you know, I don't beat myself up because I can't do it fully now. But the more you grow, the more you appreciate that. Grace be to you. There's the favor of God. And peace, there's the felt enjoyment of that favor come together. Paul's epistles are designed to communicate that to you. By the way, you notice it says from God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. It doesn't say from the Father and from the Lord Jesus. It says one. There's one source of grace and peace. And it comes from both the Father and the Son. You notice he's the Lord Jesus Christ. That's his full title. So what you're going to learn is you're going to learn about this plan that comes out of the heart of God, out of his innermost thinking. And it's going to set forth for you the fullness of all that Jesus Christ is. All the fullness God has put into him. Now, the two great issues in that. One is a dispensational issue. I'll talk a little bit about it next time to you. When it says grace and peace, if you write down by that verse, Revelation 19, verse 11, you'll see the opposite. Brother Alex is talking about it in the first session, where the heavens open and the Lord and Jesus Christ comes back in his second advent out of the heavens, and it says he comes to judge and make war. The opposite of grace is judgment. The opposite of peace is war. And what Paul is telling you when he says in each of these epistles, grace and peace from God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ, is he's telling you that God's attitude toward things today is different than it's going to be in the future and that it has been in the past. And you go back to Acts chapter 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7, and you'll see that Jesus Christ, when he ascended into heaven, sat down at the Father's right hand, specifically, Psalm 110, verse 1 says, until the time came to make his foes his footstool. So in Acts 7, when you see him standing up, scripturally, what's he standing up to do? The time had come to make his foes his footstool, initiate the day of his wrath. But it didn't happen. You say, why? Was he Peter wrong? No, you know what the issue is. God interrupted the dispensational. He put a parenthesis in the timeline, something he'd planned to do, just didn't tell anybody about. There's a tremendous issue about it, and that's why it's called the dispensation of the grace of God. Things are different today in God's attitude toward the world. It's not wrath and judgment and war. It's grace and peace. But there's a specific personal application of that dispensational truth that I'm trying to get at today. Ephesus was Satan's very headquarters and seat of activity in Asia Minor in Paul's day. It was a focal point of idolatry, of superstition, of wealth, of luxury, of corruption. We looked at all that back in Acts 19. It was a society rotten to the core. It was a big, wicked city. It was a culture honeycombed with corruption. Sound like home to you? And yet, there was a little oasis, a garden of fragrant, flowering saints at Ephesus that had all they needed in Jesus Christ. And they trusted it. And he says, I'll fill you with joy and peace. Where? In believing. It isn't just knowing about it. It's believing it. It's trusting it. It's saying, that's the reality. And the peace comes. It comes into your life that way. You struggle. All those things we do to try to get our spiritual needs, our basic needs met, those are just the ways we seek to find and identify ourselves. Self-worth, self-acceptance, self-image kind of stuff. But you're looking in all the wrong places when you're looking everywhere but in Christ, when you're looking apart from Christ. I'll fill you with joy and peace. You know what that joy is? Remember in Philippians, contentment. Godliness with contentment is great gain, Timothy. You want peace in your life, in your heart? That's where you find it. You want peace in your marriage, in your family? You want peace in your work life, on your job, with your neighbors? You want peace in an assembly? You know where you find it? You find it right here. It comes from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. It comes from His grace. That's where the peace comes from. And it comes when you trust Him, when you believe it, when you rest in it. We used to sing a little song down south, all that I need is in Jesus. He satisfies, joy, He supplies. Life would be worthless without Him. All things in Jesus I find. Grace and peace to you from God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. I hope that's yours. I hope the peace is yours because the grace is. And your faith just needs to rest in an understanding of who God's made you in His Son. If you've never trusted Him, that's all available for you today. There's no religion involved. There's no performance that you can accomplish that's going to make you acceptable. It's not through your obedience. It's through the obedience of Christ that we're made righteous. I love that verse. It's your faith resting in Him that makes it a reality. But once you become a saint, now is the opportunity to bring that into the reality, because God has made that your life. You know, people want to get rid of their problems. Have you noticed that sin complicates life? Ugh. And people want to get rid of the problems caused by their sin, but they don't want to change. They don't want to be changed. So you just sit there. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Behold, all things are of God. You know what happens when you trust Him? He changes you. You don't have to do it yourself. He did it for you. You just need to relax and enjoy the ride and live in the reality of who He's made you. Father, we thank You today for Your grace, so freely given to us, so totally beyond our even ability to ask or think sufficient. And we thank You for the peace, the tranquility, that relaxed heart that it gives us when we trust it. I pray for every person in this room, here, on the internet, wherever, that it might be as real and rich to each one of us as it is to you, and you desire it to be for us. In Christ's name. Amen. We're going to stand and sing.